Woo! Howdy, partner. Hop on board. We're headed out to settle the frontier. Except this time, the frontier is on another planet. Okay, don't panic. I'm not really on Mars. Plus, this thing smells funny. The point is that according to the Mars Society, Earth is old news. The real party is here on the red planet, baby. So, if our species is truly going to be in it for the long haul, we gotta figure out how to live in places like here. But are you interested? How much longer until we're not a single planet species?
Well, I hope that we can get to Mars in my lifetime. We are looking to be in the 2030s to start the Mars missions timeframe.
That's Marshall Smith, and he's the head director of human lunar exploration programs at NASA. His job is to lead the teams that are working to get humans to the moon by 2024 and then to Mars in the 2030s. What is moon to Mars, and why have these plans been expedited?
This has been in our long-term plan for quite a while. We had a plan that was to get us to the surface of the moon in 28. We've accelerated it to 24.
So, NASA's plan to get back to the moon has been accelerated to 2024 by the order of the president. And from there, they'll develop sustainable human presence on the moon by 2028. So in 10 years, when you look up at the moon, there will be people living there. And after all of that, the infrastructure developed from these trips will help NASA get to Mars in our very near future.
We did Apollo in 9 years. And that would probably not have happened if we didn't have that commitment from the president and the administration. We've got that same commitment now from the president and the administration to go forward and expedite, and let's take the next step.
Okay, let's put this into perspective. A trip to the moon could take up to 3 days, while a trip to Mars could take up to a few months. And the full journey could take astronauts a full 3 years before they get back home. A few years ago, the Mars One project made news by creating sort of a reality show that planned very literally to establish a Mars colony by 2032. The only catch for the participants? It was gonna be a one-way ticket. And once you got there, it was pretty certain that something, at some point, was going to kill you. And probably in a pretty awful way. It's an interesting idea. Let's find some brave pioneers who are willing to take the greatest of all risks. The question is, how do you motivate people to make that kind of leap? Well, last time we did something like this, it was pretty simple. We paid them. A few hundred years ago, the American frontier wasn't that different from Mars. It was rugged, it was unpredictable, and there were plenty of things that could kill you.
In the 1840s, the Donner Party was caught in the Sierra Nevada mountains. And they starved to death because they were caught in the winter and they couldn't get out. The tragedy of the Donner Party is that because they ran out of food, they started eating the dead bodies.
But here's the key. For the government, it was essential that lots and lots of people take the risk. So they had to figure out what sort of reward was worth this risk.
One of the things that they did was they gave land away free. It was called the Homestead Act, and it was passed in 1862. And that if a person went to, say, Nebraska or points west, they could get land up to 160 acres for free. All they had to do was live on it and improve it.
The United States government gave away free or cheap land to encourage settlers to move and set up homesteads out in the West. Now, we'd be remiss if we didn't bring up that colonization is a continually dark chapter in the history of indigenous peoples, from which European settlers have profited. Mars, as you can guess, is probably a tougher sell. Farmland? Nope, not yet. Religious freedom? I guess, maybe, if you found a way to build a Mars church or something, and a chance to live however you want. Sure, just don't take off your helmet or forget to clean your carbon dioxide scrubbers 3 times a day. All I'm saying is that it's probably going to take more incentives than it did last time.
Could you see that happening with Mars in an advent where it's like, hey, nobody really wants to go out there, potential death could happen at any point in time. Could you see people getting large sums of money to possibly go out to Mars to inhabit it?
And in the early stages of our exploration of Mars, they discovered some fascinating, amazing, new kind of mineral so that a person could make a lot of money by being there. just to go there and sit in a Martian desert was probably not very much of an incentive.
And you say it's part of NASA's spirit to explore. If Mars is an inhabitable planet, at what point do you believe, in your opinion, that it would turn from exploration to potential colonization or civilization in NASA's mission? Or would that never be NASA's mission and that would take some outside of type of entity to make that happen?
I don't know the answer to that question. That's a good policy question for people above my pay grade, but I can tell you that, you know, those are things that we think about, you know, what are the next steps?
But NASA doesn't like using the word colonization. They're not looking into a continuous human presence in deep space, but they are interested in building an infrastructure for private companies to enter into that field. They described it like building the railroads for settlers to move out west. For you and NASA, what are we hoping to learn or get out of going to Mars? Like, what is the point of the journey?
You know, we know that there's flowing water on Mars. We've seen it, we've documented it. There are things like Mars quakes. You know, we understanding the geology of Mars, as a Mars is a planet that was, we think, maybe Earth-like some long time ago. And so studying that might help us understand the future of Earth.
There's one other historical parallel we need to consider here. The last time there was this much land settled in our country, there were major players involved, including Britain, France, Spain, Portugal, and the Netherlands. And as we know, to the winner went the spoils.
Today, there's a similarly complicated power struggle forming in space with China, Russia, India, Israel, not to mention the private sector, all doing what they can to claim a piece of the pie. Last time, the winner would get to become the ruler of the free world. Tomorrow, maybe the winner will become ruler of the free solar system.
We've definitely been working closely with our international partners. Matter of fact, I have a meeting today with a country that's coming up that wants to participate in this endeavor. I know somebody that says, if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together.
So this is a lot different than the space race.
Well, 50 years ago, we were in a race with the Russians, and now they're one of our partners on the International Space Station. And as we move forward, we're in discussions with them about how they want to participate and we're how we move forward. So yeah, so it's definitely a different flavor.
The real question is, beyond the dollars and cents, is it worth it? There was a time when the American experiment depended on lots of fresh blood and muscle. The argument today is that our collective future may depend on a new type of expansion.
Between overpopulation, climate change, and maybe simply running out of space on Earth.
So, if we don't figure it out, this whole dog and pony show known as humanity, it's all for nothing. Though it may not be part of NASA's current mission, is it important for humans to be able to live on other planets?
I personally think so. I read a lot of science fiction, mainly because I like it, but I see these civilizations that are multi-planet civilizations that I think, you know, if we're gonna always be on Earth, I think Earth has got its set of resources and that's it. Other planets have other resources. To me, today, we're taking the baby steps, the initial steps, to expand our human presence beyond the Earth permanently. And where does that leave us? Do we go to the asteroids next? Do we go to planets surrounding Jupiter? Those are the kinds of things that I think we need to take the steps for today to make happen in the future.
So here we are. Potentially, there's a future where we'll need to pay people to rocket off to their deaths. Or maybe, just maybe, to rocket off to something closer to a utopian science fiction wonderland where the future really is limitless. And that's why we want to hear from you. If America was ours to make today, would we consider paying the families of Mars colonists? And how much should we pay them? Or is this all nonsense? Let us know.
PBS is bringing you The Universe with Summer of Space, which includes six incredible new science and history shows streaming on PBS.org and the PBS video app, along with lots of spacey episodes from PBS Digital Studios creators. Follow me over to Reactions to check out their Summer of Space episode on What the Moon Smells Like.
Woo-hoo! I'm just really good. Jesus Christ. Woo! Howdy, partner!